In 1976, now prolific director Martin Scorsese released one of his earlier feature-length films, Taxi Driver. The film follows Travis Bickle, a Vietnam veteran turned cab driver working in a stylishly decrepit New York City. The plot's conflict, for the most part, arises from Travis's relationship with two female characters, Betsy and Iris. Betsy is a career woman working for the presidential campaign of Senator Palentine, with Travis seeking some sort of romantic connection with her before being rejected. Iris is a 12-year-old child prostitute who Travis wants to help escape from her unfortunate situation. Throughout the movie's runtime, Travis slowly becomes more desperate in his search for purpose, up until the last 20 minutes or so, when he realizes that his whole life has been pointed in one direction.
Now I see it clearly. My whole life is pointed in one direction. I see that now. There never has been any choice for me.
First, he makes an attempt on the life of Senator Palentine, but he's stopped by security. Then, he takes part in a gruesome shootout with the group that employs Iris, leaving him in a coma. Following that, a letter from Iris's parents is read out, stating that Travis is a hero for saving their daughter, along with newspaper clippings praising him for his good deeds. The final scene before the credits shows Travis with Betsy, who seems to have gravitated towards him again after hearing about him in the papers. But something odd happens after she gets out of the taxi. Just before the dreamlike credit sequence, Travis sees something in his mirror. Earlier in this scene, note how, until she steps out of the taxi, Betsy is always framed by that same mirror, and how she seems to simply appear in the taxi as if she was there before Travis got in, which is of course nonsensical. This calls into question how reliably the scene is told, and how much of it can be taken on its face. Is Betsy's presence here simply a figment of Travis's imagination? Is the scene even happening in a literal sense, or is this a dream of his during his coma? Maybe he really did die in the shootout, and these are his dying thoughts, his fantasy of how he's praised as a hero for the path he took. And what if he was able to go through with his assassination attempt on Palentine, and that was the story people were left with of Travis Bickle's legacy? Would this still be his fantasy, where people hear of him in the papers as a hero, just as much for murdering a politician as he was for saving a young girl from child trafficking? Then, if these questions can be raised for this scene, what about the rest of the movie? I think you can make the argument that Travis's dates with Betsy are entirely a delusional fantasy for Travis, where he steals this woman from a lesser man at her work purely through his own charisma.
Because I think that you are the most beautiful woman I've ever seen.
During all the scenes where they speak to each other, Travis is dressed in a nice suit compared to the more modest outfit he has on for the rest of the movie. And compared to the way that Betsy talks with her aforementioned co-worker, she is far more monotone and less expressive when out with Travis. This builds on a clear motivation of his character, that being the affection of women and women's approval of him, with Betsy taking the form of his ideal woman. But even within Travis's mind, that fantasy slowly breaks down, which ends with him going into the campaign building, now in his normal attire, to berate her.
Come on!
Look, come on!
You're in a hell, and you're gonna die in a hell like the rest
of them. Come on now! There's a cop across the street.
You're like the rest of them.
Look, I'm calling the cops. Officer!
Her reaction even leaves it ambiguous as to whether or not she's even seen Travis since she noticed him staring through the front door to the office. But regardless of whether or not any of these interpretations are the correct ones, they all build up Travis's character as a confusing, contradictory, possibly schizophrenic anomaly in a world that he sees as disgusting and without morals, hoping to do something right to help rectify that. And what extreme action he takes all comes down to the proverbial flip of a coin. Aside from being a fun conversation to have on what really happens in this story, given what hints are laid throughout, the movie's dreamlike exploration of Travis Bickle's psyche is presented as unquestioned fact, but with how strange and nonsensical his actions and some events are, that confusion and those contradictions grow to define the story and Travis's character. Regardless of what the truth behind these events are, they are told in this ambiguous way in order to strengthen the story's tone, Travis's character, and the themes evoked by this morally bankrupt city and one man's twistedly masculine quest for purpose. The point I want to establish by discussing Taxi Driver is that there are these types of stories that don't give the audience perfect information, leaving the fact of the matter of what happens in the plot up to some level of interpretation. Every story has room for interpretation of its plot to some extent, but stories like Taxi Driver embrace this ambiguity and make it a central piece in strengthening its overall feel. When used wisely, that ambiguity can very positively define a piece, but I'd like to talk about an interesting example of this phenomenon that I came across recently from a game called Omori. This game is tough for me. The day after I finished it, I wrote a short post about it, as I usually do when I play something interesting, but I think I may have jumped the gun a bit this time. Omori is a game that stayed in my head and demanded my thoughts long after I finished it, and as I thought more, my opinion on the game only soured. I agree with much of what I wrote on the game already, that big pacing issues and boring combat get in the way of the game flourishing into a true masterpiece, but this is more about what I didn't say rather than what I did. I think there's one more big flaw, though it's a bit more complicated than it just being a flaw. So let's get into that. Omori centers around a character named Sunny, a kid living in a beautiful, cheery suburban neighborhood. He grew up with a group of good friends, with the important names to keep in mind being Mari, Sunny's sister, and Basil, who is important because of the photos he took of everyone as they grew up together. However, all the conflict in the game arises when, on the day of Sunny and Mari's joint music recital, Mari dies. This quickly breaks the friend group apart, with Sunny even dropping out of school due to this sudden traumatic event. The majority of the game takes place inside Sunny's head, with his dreams acting as an escape from his lonely life in the real world, wherein he and all his friends are still together, and Mari is still alive and acting as something of a guiding mother figure for him. For most of the game, the cause of Mari's death is kept ambiguous, though there's a pretty big hint fairly early on. After returning to his dreams for the first time, the game introduces a game of hangman that must be completed by collecting keys around Sunny's dreams. Then, during the final segment taking place in the real world, the newly reunited friend group goes into Sunny's backyard for the first time, where they heavily imply that the stump in the middle of the yard is where Mari died. I thought it was so obvious where the game was going from here. The twist would obviously be that Mari abruptly committed suicide by hanging herself from the tree, and this is the cause of Sunny's withdrawal from his community and the creation of his headspace. But that's not what the twist ended up being, though it's mostly because there's one little bit added at the beginning. As told through this album of photos that Sunny collects in his dream, he actually got in a fight with Mari and accidentally shoved her down the stairs in their house, killing her. Sunny then conspires with Basil to frame her death as a suicide by hanging her already dead body from the tree in the backyard. When I first played the game, I was okay with this being the twist. If nothing else, it was subversive compared to what the game was obviously leading up to, while not being too disconnected from that buildup. But this is what I kept thinking back to after I finished this game. Aside from what potential plot discrepancies it opens up, I think this twist was a pointless attempt to be shocking and subversive, when it really didn't need to be. The ending would have worked just as well, if not better, if they went the obvious route, if not from a plot-driven perspective, then from a thematic perspective. Sunny needing to work through the grief of a sudden suicide in his family is not as shocking as him being somewhat responsible for her death, but I think it would have gone a long way in making Sunny's struggle more relatable and believable, compared to both him and Basil very intentionally framing Mari's death in order to escape responsibility. But what if that actually was the twist? There are only three times in the game where it's even implied that Sunny killed Mari. Both the photo collection scene and the fight with Sunny's dream persona Omori take place entirely within Sunny's head, and during his conversation with Basil, Sunny is clearly in a semi-delusional state as he hallucinates Basil being eaten by some sort of dark monster. So what if, in the same way that victims of abuse seem to rationalize their abuse as a personal failing, the twist that Sunny had a hand in killing Mari was a rationalization fabricated by Sunny to deal with such a sudden traumatic event? Maybe Sunny built up such a delusional sense of guilt and responsibility for her suicide, to the point that he now falsely believes he had a direct hand in it. I think everything else in the game fits just as well within this interpretation, and I think it entirely saves the ending from being an awkward attempt to be surprising that is carried by the game's excellent sense of style, transforming it into the perfect package that includes that impeccable thematic core on top of everything else the game does so well. However, as much as I want this to be the truth behind the twist, I'm reluctant to fully accept it for a few reasons. I'd say that there's a different dynamic when it comes to making these sorts of interpretations of the plot in Omori when compared to something like Taxi Driver, and that's because Taxi Driver is a story that invites these alternate interpretations in a way that advances its overall feel. The implications made by the final scene sow the seeds of doubt that can carry over to the entire rest of the story, which I think gives the audience the go-ahead to speculate in a way. Compared to this, Omori gives no such go-ahead, or even any hints at a different reality, aside from Sunny being a generally disturbed and potentially unreliable narrator. I also think it's different because of what that speculation does for the story, and how it changes the story. Taxi Driver tells a story that is shaped by that ambiguity, and that ambiguity in turn shapes the characterization of Travis Bickle, as well as the story's thematic core. Regardless of what interpretations you make of the final scene, or anything else in the movie, the story isn't shaped by those subjective interpretations, but it's rather shaped by the room the story allows for those subjective interpretations. Omori is a game whose themes are absolutely shifted by my proposed interpretation of the twist, and to some extent the quality of that story and the effectiveness of that message is contingent on it as well. The potential interpretations of the plot don't coalesce to strengthen the story as a whole, they rather splinter off, and each of those branching interpretations could hardly be called the same story. One is about Sonny forgiving himself for having a direct hand in causing his sister's death with the help of his friends, while another is about the mental burden of the sudden, tragic, uncontrollable loss of someone close to you, and the harrowing effect that places on anyone. But more than anything, it just feels wrong to me. It feels to me like I'm deliberately looking for a way to make this game work, as I found the final twist to be so mishandled. It was so close to working so well, and I found enough room in the margins of the text to essentially write my own ending to the game. But what's the line between interpreting the plot in a way that entirely shifts the story away from the more literal interpretation, and just writing a fanfiction that I tell myself is canon? How much, and under what conditions, can the audience be trusted to mold the facts of the matter of what actually happens in any story? I love finding and talking about individual interpretations of meaning in art, but when there's a disconnect on the facts of what a piece fundamentally is, I think we lose out on a lot of our ability to have that discussion. That discussion is what I care about, so I can't in good faith adopt this view of Omori's ending. So, to conclude, as much as I hate to say it, as much as I would love to fix it, I have to end with this. I don't think Omori is a very good game, I can't do anything about it, and that's how it should be. For anyone who's interested, I now have a Discord server for this channel and my other stuff like my game. The invite link is in the description, so try it out if it sounds interesting to you.